it's been said that of all cultural institutions, the classroom has changed least in the last 200 years. Things are pretty strange in this world, and people do it many ways, and you are just an atom in a galaxy of possibilities, and your opinions and your science and what I think and all that is just so much noise in a very complex and busy world. And it's that same humbling perception, I think, that comes out of psychedelics. It just shows you, you know, you're very parochial. Here's a piece of information you might find interesting. This thing for which we take such responsibility, called human history, is actually not our fault. That it had to do with being caught in a kind of magnetic field in local space that propelled genetic material toward novelty. In other words, human history is not the record of human decisions, efforts, so forth and so on. Human history is the record of the imprint upon human beings of something else's plans, dreams, hopes, and intentionality. That about 5 million years ago, give or take a million, choose a number. The quietly carrying on primates of Africa fell, if you will, like under the spell of something. They could smell something in the air, like 25,000 years or 250,000 years in the future, but they caught the odor on the air. You know, the wildebeest didn't, the gazelle didn't, the lion didn't, but the primates did. And one thing led to another is about what it comes down to. One campfire speculation led to another. One decision to push beyond the normal limits of the tribal turf led to another. And at the behest of some wavering image, some immense protean thing, I mean, for most of human history, it's just been simply called God. But I don't think it's the God that hung the stars like lamps in heaven, as in Milton's phrase. That seems a bit much to ask, since the universe is vast. I mean, galaxies like grains of sand, and so whither you and I. But it may be that there is a kind of local God, the God of biology. You know, a God for whom the fate of the earth is of extreme importance, not one of myriads strewn across the light years, but the entire playpen and investment. And this Gaian mind, you know, if intelligence could emerge in us, it could emerge in some other form, and perhaps we're wrong to expect it to always emerge, expressed through technology and language in a particulate species. If that's how it always does it, then nature waited a long time to play this trick. In other words, for 600 million years, the conquest of the terrestrial environment by life has been underway. Well then, is it only in the last 6 million years anything like intelligence would emerge? And then only in one species? Because nature is incredibly redundant. Any strategy which works is usually iterated again and again and again. Well, then people say, well, dolphins and this and that and the other. Maybe. Or perhaps, you know, new laws are new domains of potential openness are occurring as the universe ages, and complexity previously disallowed is now possible. And we are that complexity. We are nature moving out of its genetic phase, a phase under the control of chemical genes, which are physical structures, into an epigenetic phase, a phase of culture ruled by codes, transformable, culturally confined codes, mathematics, religion, philosophy, art, dance, humor. For what purpose? Well, who knows? As I said, there are people in Silicon Valley who go to work every day believing they serve the great work. And they refer to the great work as the passing on of intelligence to machines that can appreciate it. It's wasted on a monkey. You know, they are scum. but machines will appreciate it. Well, I don't know whether that's where it's going. I think it's more like a meltdown, that intelligence will always have the stamp of humanness on it, where'er it now goes, this particular branch of intelligence, because we are its phylogenetic parents. I mean, it may become a thing purely of machines, but they will revere us in great awe and seek to be morally worthy of the legacy that we handed on to them, I'm sure. Remember when I said the entire conquest of life on land occupied the last 600 million years and it was almost a straight curve into novelty? Here it is again. You see, because the time wave is a fractal, it has resonances at many levels. The same patterns occur on many, many levels. This is an opportunity or a way of offering an explanation for such puzzling phenomena as fads and fashions. You know, if suddenly we're all putting claws on our bathtub legs, clearly something has happened in the mass mind. Well, according to this theory, we're in resonance with some historical period in the past where clawed bathtubs made perfect sense. So as, you know, I've gotten this down to an aphorism, which is, Rome falls 9 times an hour. And your job, as you clean up in the kitchen and fold your socks and go to your job, is to feel every time it falls. And everything else happening. Everything happens 9 times an hour and once a day and twice a week and 3 times a year. It's all going by on different scales. And what the actual experience of being alive is being embedded in this standing waveform of temporal interference. In linear theory, the most important moment in terms of its effect on this moment is the moment which just preceded this moment. But in this theory, it says, no, the most important moment shaping this moment is a galaxy of moments scattered through time, some of them millions of years ago, some of them seconds ago, some of them centuries ago, and together they create the incredibly rich, affect-laden environment that we call being a thinking human being paying attention. You see? So in the same way that the conquest of terrestrial Earth by life forms occupied a curve like this, so too did the Greek-initiated rush toward natural science and global civilization. They followed a similar curve at different scales. And so an implication of this, if you follow me, is that if all this novelty spins together on December 21st, 2012, then in some sense, between wherever we are in time and 2012, we are reliving all of time as we make our way through time to get to that point. And with a mathematically formal theory like this, you can tell where in time you are, down to a millisecond if you're of the anal persuasion. So for example, someone said, well, so Mr. Science, where are we in time? Well, where we are in time is we're about 950 AD. In other words, we're in a period of relative cluelessness with extraordinary primitive technologies under the aegis of extremely constipated social institutions. But great, great adventure lies ahead, and there are stirrings in some quarters that indicate phenomenal development lies ahead. So we're in a kind of shadow of the medieval eschaton, and this will persist till past 2000.